I'm wearing at the moment two hats. The first hat is I'm doing a PhD externally at University of Marburg. I'm interested in this PhD on the user perspective of large volumes of data. So I run a user survey to understand how users interact with data and also how they would like to interact in the future and also what challenges they have in order to better understand how we can set up cloud-based data systems in the future. And the second hat is that I work as a freelance consultant developing Jupyter notebooks and tutorials how Copernicus data can be easier accessed and processed and visualized. I think it already comes down now to more than 10 years. I started at a university in my bachelor's just by seeing that the problems I want to solve, I can't go further with just using QGIS or ArcGIS, and so I had a need to automatize some workflows, and this was my motivation to get started with coding. And this is more than 10 years ago, and I just continued using Python and R and doing more and more and more complex things as well. Yes, I think coding, you have to have you have to self-teach yourself. So you can have a course that introduce you to the principles, but in the end where you learn coding is at home, trying out things, failing, trying out, failing, trying out, failing, getting frustrated, you just want to stop. But then there will be this moment where it works and this motivates you again to go the next step. And the path to learn coding, it's this way. So you just should never give up. I think there are many advantages for these summer schools. First of all, it is networking, so different people from different parts of the world, different research organizations come together working on different problems and projects and also interesting projects. So the exchange of what people do. And also, in terms of learning, I think it also depends on the level of where you are. The good thing is that even if you just started with coding, you get ideas and you see also, you can also talk to other people and you can come back and you can try it yourself. So because it's a large practical part here as well, so you can fetch the code from GitHub and you can also go through the code and really learn from the examples. And this is also a way how you learn coding, basically, from examples others implemented. It's just getting more exciting, more challenging, but at the same time also, let's see, if we say where we will be in 10 years, let's also see where we were in 10 years back. So 10 years back, it just started this open data movement. So still 2007, people needed to pay for Landsat images, for example. And so this really limited you to small study areas for long waiting times until the data you have. Now we have these large volumes of data with the sentinels, and now this gives us a lot of opportunities, but this also brings us to new challenges because we have these large volumes of data, but they are not accessible for everyone because now we have to find new ways how to access the data because simple downloading data is not possible anymore. So in 10 years' time, I think everyone will be, this may be a bit bold, but I think everyone will work on cloud-based data systems, even maybe without realizing it, but this is the only way how we can actually make use of this awesome open data that is available. And also in terms of machine learning, I think it's just getting easier and easier. So the algorithms, they're getting more precise, and so it's just getting easier, but at the same time also more technical. So people who are working in data science, you will need to understand also what's happening on the server side or like on background, so how much processing requirements you have and how much storage space you need, etc. So I think this will be a long learning curve for people specifically just coming from the background from data science or geospatial analysis. I'm co-founder of Women in Geospatial, so it's a network, and I think it's about it's a problem that is not solved by tomorrow. I think it's good to continue, never stop reaching out, and also also reaching out specifically to networks who are actually specialized in this and saying, okay, like a certain percentage of the spaces are really reserved for people with underrepresented genders. So this is a way how you get a more diverse crowd, for example. And there are a lot of girls and women coding. It's just about, I don't know, in integration in things and projects that work as well. And also always ask yourself if your team just has one sex, is this normal? Because our society is actually 50-50. And so, but diverse teams, diverse groups, it doesn't happen by chance. You really have to put an effort in it. And this is, I think, what everyone should do.